Before I do the introduction to Dr. Bari's background and the book that we're talking about today, in terms of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, we have gone to Bangladesh, the Cox's Bazar, to kind of investigate war crimes that have been committed. We believe it's genocide, and Dr. Bari will talk about it in detail in his presentation. But in the purpose was to kind of document and evidence whether there was genocide taking place or not. And the politics of what's happening in Myanmar is that the UN is being shy away from referring to it as a genocide because of the kind of the legal kind of apparatus that would need to be enforced if it is a genocide officially. They've called it ethnic cleansing and textbook, whatever and whatnot, but it really doesn't amount to anything if you're labeling it anything apart from genocide, because the country won't be and the leaders won't be held to be accountable. And in the short time that we were there right at the moment where the onslaught of violence kind of had just spiked again, because the Rohingya people have been suffering at the hands of the extremist government in Myanmar for a very long time, for decades, and they've been seeking refuge in places like Bangladesh, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia. But last year we saw a heavy spike of violence, and we investigated documented some of the crimes that have been committed against the Rohingya. I've been studying genocides for a very long time, but never have I ever kind of read and witnessed such accounts of violence carried out against some of the most vulnerable people on the planet Earth. There was a level of violence committed against specifically for men, but when it came to women and children, it was on another level. I was too young to remember Bosnia. I've heard about what's happened in Bosnia, I've been to Bosnia, and I've spoken to some of the survivors. But what I, in comparison to what I've seen happen to the Rohingya, is something on another level. And I have some pictures, maybe if we do have some time, we'll look at some of the pictures I've taken. But the violence against specifically the children was unprecedented. When we went to the hospital, we witnessed rooms full of children, where there's no space left on the floor, left untouched, where there's children upon children upon children. And every time we saw children, we saw a broken limb. And we asked the parents, what had happened to the children? And they said that the army officers would come and they would basically hold out a limb and stamp on it to the point of breaking it. Now, if you can imagine that violence being subjected to that individual child, and then the child having to escape their village on foot with the fear of landmines, being shot at, being killed for another 15-20 days to the Bangladeshi Myanmar border. And at that point, you have to pay smugglers to cross over, and if you don't have enough money to cross over, then you're stuck at the border, and therefore you're still at risk of being killed. So imagine having a sprain and still having to walk, but these people were had broken limbs. Women were raped in front of their husbands, their children, their mothers and fathers. Some survived, some didn't. And some of the men that have been subjected to violence were beaten to the point that they know that even if there is a slight possibility that they might want to return, they will not return to the villages because they've been subjected to such horrific violence. And this goes on and on, and the documentation of violence is just it's the same pattern. Same pattern from one village to another village. The same accounts given wherever we went. I guess in the Q&A session we'll be able to kind of ask Dr. Bari, with his experience of dealing with such crises in the past, what is the way forward? But I will kind of introduce Dr. Bari, and I guess this really does not do justice to who Dr. Bari is. So Dr. Muhammad Abdul Bari, MBE, is an educationist, community activist, parenting consultant and author. He has written for various newspapers, blogs and journals, including The Huffington Post, Al Jazeera English, and is author of a number of books on marriage, family, parenting, identity and community issues from contemporary British Muslim perspectives. He is also the was Secretary General of the Muslim Council of Britain, the largest umbrella body in the Muslim umbrella body in the UK. We'll be talking about this book today here, The Rohingya Crisis, but also we have Dr. Bari's memoir here that will be on sale today as well. So Dr. Bari, hand it over to you, and please enlighten us, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulullah. Jazakumullah khair. Thank you, Ahmad al-Din. You know, in my life, I never has been a boss, because our boss, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, considered his everyone as his companions. So we were good companions in the MCB in the very difficult time of the 77. So all my interest in this country has been to work with the British Muslim younger generation since I got into community activism, then gradually it became the social activism. Now I consider myself a civil society activist in the sense that initially I started with the small Bangladeshi community, homeless Muslim community in Britain, and now overall civil society. The reason I said this, that I was more or less 100% totally involved with the British Muslim scenario. But Rohingya issue, I was aware of this because I was born in Bangladesh, in the middle of Bangladesh, but I studied in the University of Chittagong, which is near Rakhine border. So the Chittagongian Muslims and Rohingya Muslims speak in similar dialect, not exactly the same, but similar dialect. So my 5-6 years of study in Chittagong, and because wherever I did go in my life, I tried to learn their accent and dialects so that I understand them. So I learned some of the dialects, and when Rohingya start talking in the TV, I know firsthand what they have been saying. I don't have to go into any translation. So that's the first attachment that I felt. Also, I knew their first eviction, brutal eviction since 1978, when 278,000 Rohingya Muslims were brutally evicted for the first time. At that time, there was a military come democratic leader in the name of General Jiaur Rahman in Bangladesh. Somehow, he was strong and he managed to send back to the UN. And then when I joined Bangladesh Air Force in 78, and when I was in Chittagong for the second, in my posting for 5-6 months in 1982, I traveled across Chittagong as well. I traveled Chittagong, the whole region. But I didn't go to Burma until recently, that means last end of February. But I wanted to know Burma, Myanmar. Although I'm a student of physics, I love history, I read history, and history to me is important in the sense I learned that a nation which doesn't know its own history, then what is their future? So I'm a sort of avid reader of history. South Asia is my ethnic root, not only Bengali. I call myself a South Asian. And South Asian means India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, British Raj, unfortunately. And that British Raj had Myanmar or Burma as one of their provinces. Until 1935, Myanmar was ruled from Calcutta. It was not Delhi. That means it was a province of British Raj. Okay, so that's the... When I saw on 25th August and following days and weeks, hundreds of thousands were coming to Bangladesh, and in a horrible situation. Ahmad has mentioned some of this. I'm not a storyteller, but I could visualize how they have been leaving their homes, which were burning. And with all these memories, and I thought I should do something. Normally, people of my age or Muslims, normally, whenever any calamity happens, students anywhere in the world, Muslims and non-Muslims, they come and raise some funds or money and try to give. That's the normal practice. And I was also secretary of Muslim Aid, one of the biggest charities. But I thought this money, somebody will raise, and UN is there to help. Of course, funding is important, but what about their memory that has to live? And I'm not saying that I'm the only one who is trying to keep their memory, but unfortunately, Muslims diaspora, anywhere in the world today, are probably most passive when it comes to writing history or reading and writing. That's my understanding of the Muslim communities. And when I go to any house or anywhere, I see whether there is in the bookshelf. I was really impressed coming here and see beautiful books in this beautiful building. But in many Muslim houses, there is not a single shelf. I'm digressing a bit because this is what we are Muslims at the moment in most situations. So I thought, because I have had an attachment with the Rohingya by virtue of knowing their dialect, let me write something which at least, if not an academic, but at least a concise book that will remind people, especially of Rohingya diaspora, and secondly, Bangladeshi diaspora in the West. Because Bangladesh is the worst sufferer of this crisis. And I mentioned it's 1.1 million out of 1.6 to 1.8 million Rohingya. 1.1 million are in Bangladesh, in Fox's brother's area. So Bangladesh is a heavily populated country, 160 or 70 million, and another 1 million. So Bangladesh is helping them. But it is at the cost of many things. Bangladesh doesn't have that many friends globally, unfortunately. So this is small book, around 100 pages. It's just meant to energize some of the activists in the Bangladeshi diaspora as well as Rohingya or Burmese Muslim diaspora to take up the issue within themselves so that in the next generation, probably 20, 30 years time, I'm talking of generation, not years. Some within Bangladeshi and within the Rohingya or Burmese community will realize that they have to do something better than their current generation is doing. So that's the story. So if you go to the next pages, thanks good, Dr. Kumbha Khairi is working. So as of today, 700,000 have taken shelter in Bangladesh from 25th August 2017, and making a total of 1.1 million, because out of three evictions, 1978, 1991, 92, 2016, there are 300,000-400,000 Rohingya already were there in different, in that. So it's 1.1 million. And as I mentioned, the population of Rohingya is 1.6 to 1.8 million. A few hundred thousand diaspora Rohingyas are abroad, say some are in Saudi Arabia, some in very few in Rohingya, in England. I met some of them in the one of the Indian sessions. So a few hundred thousand maximum, some in India, 14,000. And a few hundred thousand are in IDP camps within Rakhine. That means internally displaced people's camps. They are just like prisoners. And a few hundred thousand living as semi-prisoners in Rakhine, especially in the southern. Northern Rakhine, Rakhine is a not to be, but northern Rakhine, in some places, Mongdo and Butitong and some places, 90 to 95% are Muslims. So they are personally banished from there. And so that's the situation. Internal situation is Rohingya socio-political leadership and capacity destroyed over decades. Started from Burma's independence in 1948, but especially after the military junta coup of war, they win, in 1962. Low confidence and self-trust due to decades of denial of rights and vicious persecution. So once the community suffers this, they don't have confidence in themselves. They lose their confidence. They lose their self-respect. And that's what mostly happens. And Burmese Muslims as a whole also suffering from low confidence, fear, and identity crisis. I was there for 1 week in Rohingya, and I talked with people. I visited, I went to different places. I went to Mandalay, the second city. So 1 week is not that long time. But because I knew the history a bit, so I tried to figure out as much as possible. I wish I could have stayed for 1 month or more. Now, external condition is Myanmar government's ruthless anti-Rohingya politics, and that has been going since 1962-63, and in cunning global politics. Globally, they are playing politics, playing one against the other, because Myanmar is a very resource-rich country, and China needs access to Bay of Bengal or Indian Ocean. So China is, although sometimes there are frictions with China and Myanmar, but China is their backers, like America is a backer of Palestine. Whatever happens to Israel, America will support it. Exactly similar situation. Bangladesh gave shelter to the Rohingya, but sadly lacks global friends. Even India is playing politics with this. India is Bangladesh's closest friend. And India wanted to evict 14,000 Rohingya people who came before 25th August last year. But out because of the UN pressure, it's going to do. But Modi's government is like Trumpian government. You never know what can happen. So the next slide, inshallah. I'll just go through some of this scenario. It will just help me recap what I know. It's useful for me as well. Now the Rohingya history. Myanmar military junta say they are the product of British colonialism. True, during the British colonialism, many Indians and some Bangladeshis of Chittagongari origin went to Myanmar, but they just added to the already remaining Rohingya people in Rakhine. It was called Arakan state. So Arakan and Rakhine, exactly the same. Arakan is the previous name, Rakhine is the Burmese name. So they started in the 8th to 10th century, that means the early period of Islam. And you know, Muslims are traders. They went to different places with trade. And they were wonderful traders in the sense they were da'i, they were traders, their honesty, their habit and culture captivated human beings wherever they settled. People en masse became Muslims, wherever they went. So that was the period when Bengal's Chittagong, where I studied in the university, and the Irrawaddy River Delta in Burma. So these are the two areas where Irrawaddy River Delta is south of Rakhine. It is in the mainland Burma. But Rakhine became a province, or Arakan, where Muslims settled, and Chittagong settled because Chittagong was part of the Bengal Sultanate. So as a result, there were some similarities, there was differences as well. In 1055, Christian era, first Burmese empire by the pagan king that was established. So Burma was not even a Buddhist empire at the time. It was 1055. Now in 1406, Arakanese king was defeated by another Burmese king. So what he did, Burmese king, he took shelter in Bengal. And Bengal Sultanate was a good Muslim Sultanate. And so he just saw the culture in the Bengal, or at that time it was not Bangladesh, Bengal. And he was highly influenced by Bengali Muslim culture. Bengali Muslim culture and Arakani culture was more or less Persian, Turkish, the mixture of everything. So without converting to Islam, he adopted his name as Sulaiman Shah Solomon Shah. If you read the history of Arakan history, most of the rulers of Arakan, especially from 1430 to 1784, 350 years or more. During that time, there are mostly Buddhist emperors, but they took Muslim names. They were so influenced by Muslim culture. They took Muslim names. In their code, they used the Muslim kalima as the symbol, and the Persian was the state language, like the Mughal Empire in India. So what happened? In 1430, Samun Shah, or Sulaiman Shah, regained kingdom with the help of Bengal Sultan. So that continued for 300 plus years. Now what happened in 1784 and 85, Burmese king conquered Arakan again. So one is overall Burma. Arakan is the western tip of Burma, which is the Bay of Bengal side. Okay, now 1826, Arakan lost to English occupier. So that's how Arakan lost its, Arakan means current Rakhine, lost its independence. The next slide, please. Okay, very briefly, British rule. Three phases of British occupation. 1826, as I mentioned, Arakan was conquered by Britain. And 1852, southern Burma. 1885, the rest of Burma. So from 1885 to 1948, the whole of Burma, along with India, was under British rule. It was called British Raj in the beginning. Then after 35, Burma became a separate protectorate. Okay, British divide and rule policy. And that is historical. And if someone doesn't know the British divide and rule history, then there is a problem. Because even in Britain, in here, unfortunately, with British citizens who are Muslims, there is a divide and rule policy. I will not go into that discussion. Anyway, so majority Buddhists saw British favoring minority groups. So British, what happens? British was a colonial power, and their colony was mainly for economic benefit of Britain. So what happened? They saw that Burmese or Rakhine Buddhists were lazy, very lazy during that time. Britain wanted to cultivate Rakhine's land. So they then took hundreds of thousands of Indians and Bengal people at that time, not Bangladesh, to Rakhine. So they became the backbone of British economy in Rakhine. And so for shortage of Buddhist skilled labor, British brought economic migrants. Buddhist hatred for Indians and Rohingya rose in early 20th century. There was an issue for that. One was because Indians and Bengali, and at that time not only Muslims, the Indians, Hindus and Sikhs and Muslims, Bengali Hindus, Sikhs and Muslims. When you see India, there are 3-4 religions. When Arakanis or Rakhine Buddhists saw that they were taking over business and everything, so there's a hatred because they were the majority Buddhists. But, and in 1930s global economic crisis, what happened? Many Buddhist farmers, they had to lend their lands to Indians for money to survive. And as a result, many Indians became the landowners. So it was the situation was that was the British period. And economy more or less helped, the economic situation helped the Indians and Bengalis to become landowners. And that create a hatred and dislike against Indians and Bengalis within the Rakhine or Arakanese Buddhists. Then there was a nail in the coffin in the sense, 1940 to 45, Japan occupied or invaded, not only Burma, it invaded Indochina and massive lands. So Japan was virtually colonizer, so even part of China was Japan's territory. The majority Buddhists supported Japan. Rohingya and other minorities supported Britain. Rohingya were Muslims, There are the Karens, there are Shans, there are many other communities. There are 135 ethnic communities and many religious communities in Burma. All of them are granted their ethnicity, apart from Rohingya. So Rohingya definitely supported Britain. So that dislike or hatred between Rakhine Buddhists and Rakhine Muslims or Arakanese Muslims, that became sharper at that time. There were tit for tat retaliation by Rakhine Buddhists and the Rohingya Muslims, especially in the northern Rakhine, among the Budhidong and other places. General Aung San Suu Kyi's father supported the Japanese in the beginning. But because he was a great leader, and I will come to that later on, because he was the vice president of all Burma students group, and the chairman, the president was a Muslim. So he had a very good relationship with, Susi's father has a relationship with Muslims, but changed side before Japan surrendered. So he became a nationalist Burmese leader, and who negotiated independence from 45 until 47. But what happened? He formed Burmese military called Thakmado. Burmese military is indebted, or he is called the founding father of Burma or founding father of Burmese military. So he formed the Thakmado. But what happened? He had a cabinet. That cabinet was before independence. And in one of the meetings in Mandalay, the second city which I visited, there was a bomb blast, and half of the cabinet, including Aung San Suu Kyi's father, were just butchered or killed. And one of the top Muslim leaders also was killed. He was Aung San's virtually mentor. So that was a sad thing for Burma, because Aung San and his team or cabinet were multi-ethnic and pluralist, and they wanted to have equal rights for all the citizens. So he was assassinated personally. The whole cabinet was assassinated in 1947. Next slide, please. Now, military cruelty. This is where the Rohingya's current history begins. So 1948 to 62, before the militarism that took over, there are issues. There are Rohingyas were not having good times, but at least they were recognized as in there were Muslim MPs, there were Muslim cabinet, where there were civil servants. So they are present in the parliament and government institution. 62 coup and aftermath, over 300,000 Indians means Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims, were forcibly asked to leave Burma in 1962-64. So they were just, they started this scorched earth policy, the Burmese military junta. Rohingya rights were gradually taken away. Government used Theravada Buddhism, that's the main Buddhism in Burma. And in Bangladesh, Chittagong area where I studied, there are called Chakma Buddhists. They are more or less similar Buddhists, but they are different from the Burmese Theravada. Different in the sense, they are more liberal, the Chakma Buddhists. So 1970, I mentioned 250,000 plus, where it's called Operation Dragon King or Nagami. 1982, citizenship formally denied. In the meantime, the military was just playing games. So they lost the citizenship in spite of UN call against discrimination. So Rohingya became stateless. So overnight in 1982, the Rohingya people became stateless. 1992, Suu Kyi's National League for Democracy, NLD, won 392 out of 492 seats in election. But junta refused to hand over power to her. And 1991-92, another 250,000. So my story comes from here, because I was in either Bangladesh or coming to England for trade, Air Force training in 1978. Next slide. Okay, so I wanted to mention some of the things, whether it's genocide or ethnic cleansing. UN has formally said it's ethnic cleansing. although even Human Rights Commissioner has mentioned that that it could end up in genocide, and he even has asked some governments to take Burmese junta to the ICC. Okay. Omar Toshen, the Nobel laureate in Bangladesh, originally from Bangladesh, but he's a Cambridge professor of economics, he called it a slow genocide in 2014. Yale Law School called it a strong evidence of genocide in 2015, that is over 3 years ago. Queen Mary University of London's ISKI, ISKI is a full name, wrote a big book, a report, and it called it full genocide. And they have now revised that, they have published a new document, and they are now called it full genocide. So someone called Professor Penny Green, she is the head of law faculty. She and her team spent over a year before that, before 2015. The textbook example of ethnic cleansing, that is even September 27th. Amnesty International, November 17th, called it an apartheid. And BBC Newsnight called it a monstrous crime. Okay, so when I said genocide, so there are the definition. There are two, three definitions of genocide, and definitions means categories of people. And some have said that there are eight categories, but Queen Mary College, Penny Appeal and ISKI team used following categorization of genocide according to the established norms that people understand, the experts understand. One is the stigmatization and dehumanization. The other is harassment, violence, and terror. Then isolation and segregation. Systematic weakening of the target group. Mass annihilation, erasure of the target group. That's the last. So the first four were the precursor of the full genocide. And Queen Mary College's ISKI's report of 2015 mentioned that first four were fulfilled. But the second two, in the last from 2017 until now, because the whole community is now either in IDP camps or in their own prison houses, or majority, two-thirds are in Bangladesh. So that means the Rakhine personally has become Rohingya free. And international journalists and human rights organizations were not allowed to go into the northern Rakhine, and house burning and others, nobody knows what is happening. So everything is being rebuilt for probably something else. And erasure of the target group is the ultimate. So they want to erase, that's why I decided to write facing extinction. They're virtually facing extinction, not as a community because people are living somewhere else, but they are rootless. So extinction from their homelands, extinction from their root, ethnicity, and because they're denied of their ethnicity. Out of 135 ethnic people in Burma, Rohingya is not recognized in any ethnic groups. And the language that the Burmese generals and their ambassadors in different places use is inversion of reality. They say that it is safe, and they are maintaining the human rights of Rohingyas, something else. You cannot imagine how people can talk in this language the modern days. Next slide, please. Now, my visit to Burma was just to know how the overall Muslims are doing in Burma, because Rohingya is just in the western part of coastal part of Burma, but there are millions of Muslims, Burmese Muslims, and convert as well as Arab origin or Indian origin. So government estimate is only 4%. Out of 53 to 54 million Burmese, government says 4% are Muslims, whereas Muslims say 8 to 10%. Wherever I had been, and I I have read the documents, different documents, Muslims claim that 8 to 10%. Now, they are Muslim bodies, but have very little role or influence now. I met quite a few of them, especially Islamic Legal Affairs Council, IRAC. I met with their cabinet and had a long discussion with them. The chair is an elderly gentleman of 82. He came twice to see me and talk with me. And I went to their office. It's an established, good established office. And the chair of that organization was even selected as one of the advisors to Susi's government. But now Susi doesn't want to do that. Then Myanmar Muslim Youth Organization. Some of them were born in, came in 1945, that means before independence, so they are not new. Only one was Myanmar Muslim National Affairs, 1889. Molubi organization is the term I learned, because Molubi in the Asian where the scholars. So there's some of them called Molubi organization. Now, Jamiatul Ulama, they were the group of Indian origins. These are still recognized Muslim bodies in Burma. Not in the Rakhine, but they are just by name now. They don't have any influence, they don't have any connections with anyone. And some of the leaders used to know Suu Kyi and talked with her in the past. She is a totally changed person after she became the state counselor. Key Muslim figures. If you go through key Muslim figures in Burma, you will find dozens of names, but three names came to my mind. And they are highly respected in their own ways, especially one called U Rajak. U means Abdul Rajak. U is a Burmese one out of respect. U Rajak was born in 1892 or sometime. And he was a renowned educationalist and activist. He was not only Aung San Suu Kyi, means Suu Kyi's father's friend, he was his mentor as well. So he, U Rajak and Aung San and a few others of his cabinet were in the meeting in Mandalay, and they were massacred. And some people, there's still argument, it's probably that military general, Ne Win, who came after 15 years, they did it, probably. U Rashid, he was president of all Burma Students Union, alongside president of Rangoon University Students Union. So simultaneously, like anywhere in this country. So he was Rangoon University Students Union head, as well as president of all Burma Students Union. Aung San was his vice during his student life. So they are very close. The most recent one, and since then there hasn't been that many Muslim leaders, because you know when Muslims, when Rohingya and Burmese Muslims were losing their importance, you cannot produce that many that many prominent people. One was U Kony, and he was just slaughtered last year because he was a human rights and constitutional lawyer of global importance. He wrote 6 books. And all the UN negotiation with the Burmese, UN health negotiation with the Suu Kyi and the Burmese generals. U Kony was Suu Kyi's right hand man as a legal advisor. And the concept of Suu Kyi is, you know, state counselor, this formal post was created by him. So he went to Indonesia with many of his senior friends to talk with the Indonesian governments to seek help in various ways. When he returned to, while he was going over this country, I forgot, he was gunned down in Rangoon Airport. And
What year was it?
2017. It doesn't come in here somehow. 2017, January 29th. That was last year, 1.5 years ago. He was gunned down in Rangoon, and it happened in the television camera. And the Burmese government was sorry for that, and caught the perpetrator. So a taxi driver caught him, a non-Muslim taxi driver, got hold of that. He was arrested. And he has the Burmese judiciary said that he probably had some grudge against him, something. In his funeral, Ukoni's funeral, there were tens of thousands of Muslims and non-Muslims. Suchi didn't attend his funeral. That was a big news against Suchi in Burma. When she realized that she made a mistake, probably 6 months later, there was a discussion like this on Wu Koni, and Suchi attended and gave a talk. So that is Suchi. Now, people I met in Burma, just to show that what I tried to learn, because I'm not sure whether I'll be able to go again to Burma, but this has helped me in keeping in touch with many people. One of the Muslim leaders and IHRC leaders who I mentioned, there's an organization that is trying to bring people together, that they train people, SMILE, Swedish Building Group. They have got branches in Rangoon and Mandalay. Leaders of Rangoon Political School, there's a Muslim political school that has trained hundreds of non-Muslim Burmese. So some work is going on behind the scene to bring then people in the aid sector, Muslim aid, etc. Rohingya community leaders, those who are settled in Rangoon. I met one leader who is from Kuthitong, and he's 75 years old. He picked me up from the airport, and I stayed a couple of half a days with him, and he was an MP in Rakhine, but he's totally gone now. And a wide array of leaders in Mandalay is the second town, 150 or 200 miles north. And the interpreter, my interpreter there in Mandalay, was the one who interpreted Ashin Viratu. Have you heard his name? In time he is going to face of terror. And he is known as Buddhist Bin Laden by some Western people. Okay. But what I observed is cosmopolitan Rangoon, where I found Muslims generally laid back, very laid back. They don't have any, they are just living there. Okay? People go to the mosque and people don't socialize with themselves. So there is virtually no life in the Burmese Muslim in Rohingya. Whereas Rangoon is the place where Muslim Mughals, you know, the last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Jafar, I went to his bazaar. He was banished after 1857. Okay. Burmese Muslims are in the shock and suffering from a lack of a wider vision and unified approach. Next one. Okay. This is what I discuss with in different places. What should we do? And our expectation, especially my expectation, is not that high, in the sense that I mentioned in my book about what China is doing, what India is doing as a major power. America's national interest doesn't help it, and also under Trump, America is rudderless. And ASEAN countries where Malaysia, Indonesia, and Brunei are there, virtually toothless, unfortunately. So, unfortunately, Burmese Muslims, Rohingya Muslims, expect that the West or Muslim one will do something for them. But I don't see any light in the tunnel. Okay, so the long-term goal must be, and this is what the Muslims and human rights groups people having conscience to press the government, national government like British, France, and the international community, that Rohingyas must be fully repatriated with full citizenship rights to their homeland under UN supervision. That is the goal. Whether this is going to happen at all, when it will happen, nobody knows. Thanks. Okay. This is not what.
Thank you very much.
Give him a stride or something. Okay, that is the demand. That demand has to be kept alive. And At the moment, it looks like impossible. But nobody knows. In history, things change. And how things change, nobody can even visualize. So what we can do as people in here, or civil society, or activists in the street, is keep the issue alive by civil society activism, not only Muslim activism. We need to bring in wider, say, British civil society, non-Muslims particularly, human rights lawyers, and recently in the last few months we have formed the Justice for the Rohingya Minority. We are trying to do something in that manner. Lobby the UN, EU, ASEAN countries. Well, we know that UN is paralyzed, EU is struggling, ASEAN countries, we know that, but even then, we have to work hard. We should keep our lobby alive. Influence some influential governments, especially those of the US and UK. UK was a colonial power. And UK, I mentioned this to Dominic Grieve and a few others, that look, I know Britain doesn't have global power now. It's now fifth or sixth in the rank. Now America, China, Russia, probably now India is coming. But Britain has some power that many countries don't have. That is their diplomatic skills. Britain is a diplomatic superpower. Britain can maneuver things. Because Britain's got high-skilled diplomats and who understand global politics, because they are running the empire historically. They know where to hit, what to do, what not to do. They know this. Britain, if it wants, can make change, can even manipulate America in some way or other. Whether that will do it, I don't know. But pressure should be kept on Britain, especially Britain, because we are British citizens. Use legal route to keep pressure on the Myanmar government and some key perpetrators of genocide. That's one of the ways, a citizens' court, or pushing the UN and ICC to create a case against some of the generals or core commanders who have done havoc, who created a havoc in Rakhine, the rape, mutilation, the worst human rights abuses. Rape has become a weapon. And also seriously improve capacity of the Rohingya and Burmese Muslims, Muslim diaspora communities, in particular the West. This is what I personally feel I can contribute something, because I have been a community activist. And if, say, a dozen or half a dozen to one dozen young Rohingya or Burmese Muslim student leaders in university, ISOC leaders or NUS leaders, but they have to be involved in the student politics. They can make their name, they can one day become a counselor or one day become MP. And also some of them can be joined the media. They can do huge things where Rohingya Muslims in their own country or in different countries will not be able to do this. Because British media and American media is still are source of information for the world population. Improve cooperation, coordination for diverse works on the Rohingya. Rohingyas are fragile. Burmese Muslims and Rohingya Muslims are fragile everywhere now, unfortunately. That is, you know, when people are subjugated and persecuted for many, many decades, there is internal rivalry, there is small things divide people. And it's obvious, we cannot blame them. You know what's happening in Syria, Iraq, and other countries. They are highly developed countries which was never colonized. But even Syrians are killing Syrians. People have suspicion about one another. So Rohingyas are going through similar crises. It's just like Musa alayhi salam during the Pharaoh period. The Jewish community was divided. And many of them were even complaining against Musa, why have you come to give us more trouble? So that's the natural outcome of a community which is persecuted and dehumanized for generations. Prioritize Rohingya children's education wherever they are. Because I cannot foresee Rohingya people, those who are in camp in Bangladesh, or IDPs in Rakhine, or are staying in their own places without any opportunity for education and anything. I cannot envisage they can do anything for their own community now, unless there is a sudden solution. And I don't see in my eyes that there is any sudden solution unless UN decides to go anywhere. But China is there, America has to. The equation doesn't match. But Rohingya children's education, if that is gone, already there is news that there is sex traffickers and children traffickers in Bangladesh by some Rohingya culprits, criminals and Bangladeshi criminals. They're playing with the lives of the young people. That has to be looked after by the NGOs and the governments who are looking after them. And to the extent that the education of the children in the camps should be their number one priority. And to me, people like me, or say Ahmaduddin or others, Bangladeshi people who have some attachment for the Rohingya, they really can help build capacity in the Rohingya community, or be a voice for Rohingya cause in the British society, or in writing books. And so this book is a small step that I personally thought that I should do. It's a tiny little step, but people, younger people of Bangladeshi origin, if they're really serious about it, they can really bring this or keep this alive in the world. Otherwise, people will forget. You know, there are so many problems in this world. Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Somalia, Afghanistan, Palestine, of course. Why is Rohingya? Rohingya people, unless some people lobby and create this, keep this as a news, people will forget. And so the world has to be reminded of it, always. So I think that's more or less what I ought to say about the Rohingya community and our responsibility as small people on earth, probably at the moment. But I always believe and say that history is like a cycle, it always rotates. The Rohingyas were virtually rulers for 350 years, 1430 to 1784. Now they are down, the wheel has gone down. Maybe time will come, inshallah, when they will come up again. And that will probably come when those who are free at the moment, like us, who are not subjugated like them, if we really decide to help them. So, JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
If I may, Dr. Bari, can I ask you to load down the presentation? I just wanted to show some, just to compliment this last slide of Dr. Bari.
Probably one or two lines, so I'm not coming in yet. Anyway.
So if you click on that link, just press OK and then
play a video,
please. Yeah.
Okay.
Is that sound?
No, there's no sound. So this is like a video, drone footage of the Rohingya camps in Bangladesh. This is the sheer size of the largest refugee camp in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see it goes on miles upon miles? So it's farmland,
semi-mountain.
Yeah.
Hilly it is.
So if you escape that and just go to the
The slides?
Yeah, the slides, please. If you go to the next slide. So this is just I want to put into perspective. So it is the this image is old, but it is the largest refugee camp in the world. But this statistic here it's mind-boggling. So more refugees fled to Bangladesh in a matter of 3 weeks than the refugees have fled to Europe by sea over a whole period of a year, right? And due to what's happened with the refugee crisis going from parts of the Middle East into Europe, we've seen the rise of the far right. So far, you know, we've seen Hungary, we've seen Austria, we've seen Germany, we've seen Macedonia. All these countries, one by one, have fallen to the influence of the far right because of the refugee crisis. Trump is talking about what? That the identity of Europe is changing because of immigrants. And it's shocking how that one of the most poorest country in the world, the most densely populated country in the world, is accommodating over 1 million Rohingyas with very limited resources. If you go to the next slide. In terms of what Dr. Bari said in his last slide, it is we do not have the luxury of sitting idly thinking that someone else will solve this problem. You've seen the drone footage, but the right, the cat, can you imagine, this is the condition that people are living in. Now, in these makeshift tents, if you go to the next slide, please. Next slide as well. Now, so people are in the tents, people are doing everything from shower to eating to defecating to everything in a small space. Now, everything is coming out onto the ground there. When it rains, it floods everything through, and then every house or hut is basically contaminated. There's waterborne diseases. And now what's happening is that, I think the statistics is around at the low end of the spectrum, around 15,000 to 25,000 children are expected to be born in this month. Because 9 months ago, these women were raped. So what's going to happen? You've got 1 million refugees here, then you're going to have a population boom of Rohingya children that need to be taken care of. We speak about the forgotten generation in Syria and Iraq because of what's happening there. This will be on another unprecedented scale. If you go to the quickly next slide. So I was talking about some of the kind of the terrain that they had to cross over, and these are some of the makeshift bridges they had to cross over to get across to Bangladesh. So next slide, please. These are the boats we're talking about. Now, if you imagine 60 people in this boat, and most of the time they were capsizing. And if they're capsized, there are hundreds of thousands dying on a daily basis. Next slide. People come, this is what they were able to leave with, the possessions like this. Next slide. I mean, this brother's image, the facial expression that he has, when I was interviewing him, he just was being very robotic. He's going through trauma, and he's when you're asking him questions, he's just blurting it out, but like he had this kind of look on his face. Literally like he just had no emotions, but just like completely zoned out. Next slide. And most of the children were naked, it was just no clothes, can't afford clothes, don't have belongings. So this child was naked, and obviously the picture, I've not taken the full image. Next slide. This elderly gentleman he's holding onto a stick that someone is assisting him. He was beaten so severely, all his nerve endings all over his body were damaged to the point that he can't control his body. He's constantly shaking. And these were stories. I mean, this guy was lucky in comparison. There were some images that later I'll show. Carry on. This is a newly arrived family. Again, the same look on this brother's face, witnessing family members being raped, men being killed in front of them, houses being torched down. Next slide. right, so if you want to look away, look away. But I think, Dr. Bari, if you correct me if I'm wrong, but I think these images need to be shown so that we don't forget what's happened to these people. So next slide. So this is the hospital. And as you can see, there's no bed. The hospital is just full of women, room after room, room after room, all rape victims, gang raped. And they were just narrating the story one after another.
Oh.
Next page. Again, as I said, that the children, you see limbs just broken. Either it was the arm, either it was the leg. The arms or legs would be stretched out and stumbled upon and would snap. This is one example of a child. Next picture. You can see clearly from the x-ray how it's broken. Yeah? Next page. His brother, as he was running away, they threw a grenade. And this, his leg is completely was detached. It was just about hanging on. He had to, you know, walk for 20 days to get to the camps. And this is what they have to kind of put his legs together. This brother broke down when I was speaking to him. And this grandfather reminds me of my own grandfather. Mm-hmm. That's one of, like, not only is it a physical torture, but the trauma of witnessing what they witnessed. Next page. Yeah, this lady was very lucky to be alive. You can see stitches here. I counted about at least around 12 to 15 stitches here. As she was running away, they shot her, and then luckily it just passed her eyes. Next slide. So this child here, you can see burn wounds. The idea was basically they're going at 3-4 a.m. in the morning. They were going to the villages while people are sleeping. They'll attack the men, take away the girls in truckloads, never to be seen again. Children as young as that would be either be burnt or broken into. Women would be raped in front of the family members. This child was left inside the house, and while they put the fire onto the hut, they would burn villages like that. Luckily, the mother was able to pull the child away in time. So this sister, she's saying that she's lucky to be in the hospital, because as Dr. Bari spoke about the criminal gangs that are operating in Bangladesh, both Rohingya and the Bangladeshis, what they're doing is that they're kidnapping women, gang raping them, and then putting them in prostitution. Or they would be kidnapping people for organ transplantation. So they'll be making money out of people's organs. And then when you have slightly fairer looking or prettier looking women, they would be scared to get out of the houses. They wouldn't even go to the toilets because of the fear of rape within the camps. Next slide. That's it really. I mean, it's a glimpse of what I've seen, and there's I guess the what Dr. Bari has done in his effort is to keep the memories of the Rohingya alive from a historical perspective. Also, what's happening today and what we need to do today. We just do not have the luxury of just sitting back. Dr. Bari has very kindly kind of outlined kind of the different manners of helping the Rohingya population. The situation will only get worse. If you have any questions for Dr. Bari, please. Any questions?
Sorry, how many babies were expected to be born?
So at lower end of the scales, they're saying by 15,000 to 25,000 this month alone. That's the low end of the estimate. Now, the figures are much higher because officially there's only certain amounts of refugees that are recognized.
Mm-hmm.
But the refugee camp itself, it's having people coming in on a daily basis.
And who's looking after the women's health during the labour?
So it's a mixture of different NGOs, but the NGOs only have a certain reach. The Bangladeshi military is with kudos to Bangladeshi government, they're trying their best to kind of control the situation. The army is controlling who goes in, goes out, but even then it's very difficult. Now, what happens is that a lot of the women don't have male figures around to protect them anymore. They're not being vaccinated, so they are heavily pregnant with no medical attention given to them. You have NGOs are overloaded with staff with refugees going to them for assistance. You'll see many pictures of just minors just walking around, and it's not because they're walking around because they're having a good time. It's because they don't have any family. So you would have stories of as people crossing over bridges like this, the pictures I've shown, is that the one woman would say, or man would say, pass me a child, I'll pass him over, and then you can cross over, because she's got a belonging, she's got a child, and what happens is that she's trying to cross over, the child is, they will take the run off with the child. Or she's within the crowd, what happens is that she loses her child. So there's countless stories of people have lost family members as they're trying to cross over to Bangladesh. It's just not enough support is going in at the moment.
Dr.
Bari,
I have got
a
little question. First of all, you have been there, you have seen everything happening in front of your own eyes. And Alhamdulillah, the whole community is fully aware of your activities. May Allah reward you for your effort. But I'm actually concerned. I'm working in the NGO, I belong to Muslim Aid, as you know, you have been blessed for a long time. What sort of impact are you going to have? Is there anything reaching to the poor, destitute people in these circumstances? I mean, the government is so cruel, Buddhists are so cruel, that there is no humanitarian agency who is persuading them, abducting them to stop these atrocities and all that. Because we have got an office there, we have established office for the past quite 2 years now. But is it any effect? Is it effective? Is it working there? And the aid which we are from time to time sending from here, it's just a peanut, it's a drop in the ocean. You can say that's nothing. As compared to the disaster of that scale, it's nothing. But do you think, is it working? Is it reaching to the people who are desperately in need of that? Do you see any relief work? Any relief work for the people who are living there? Forget about the people who have already moved out and they are living in the camps at the moment in Bangladesh. I mean the people that you moved around and are able to meet them. Some of them are still there. You have, as you say, nearly about 700,000 people nearly already moved.
Nearly 700,000,
altogether
1.1 million.
So that's a large number. Obviously, it's a big burden on the poor country like Bangladesh. And I don't think even the. I just want your opinion.
I think Bangladesh government was initially hesitant because it was not sure what to do. Turkey plays some good role. That was probably personally called Sheikh Hasina. And you know, later on, Erdogan's wife and others visited. So, Turkey's contribution initially made things work.
They have been very successful.
And also, general population of Bangladesh, they whatever they could manage, they brought together and put pressure on the government. So, the Bangladeshi camps, as Ahmadinejad has said, they said. Because it's a massive, it's a sprawling, it's like a shanty town, slum areas.
Yes.
And even in the normal slums, say in Delhi and Dhaka and other places, there are many mishaps, there are many things happen. But these are the people who have newly arrived, they don't know the geographic locations. So there are people who prey on them.
Yes.
In the Rakhine side, I went to Muslim Aid office, in one afternoon and learn what they do. What happens? Not all Burmese people are bad. Burmese, those who look after the IDP camps, many of them have got humanity is the people who are in Naypyidaw. Naypyidaw is the capital. Rangoon is not capital anymore. So people in the Naypyidaw, that is the military junta and current Suchi's office, they are heartless, virtually heartless. Many Muslim NGOs cannot even work in because they have to get permission. And for Muslim aid, I know that Muslim aid doesn't use the word Muslim aid, it's MAUK.
Mm.
And I talked to some Muslim NGO leaders who had to go to Naypyidaw to convince or to explain what they are doing. And those who have beard, they cut short of their beard.
Beard, yes.
So Burmese military junta at the moment, they are hardcore anti-Muslim, unfortunately. And so even then in the Naypyidaw ministry, there are good people. They give hints that you do this, don't they? So you cut your beard short so that we can explain to our boss that it's okay. So if the generals and the top ranked civil servants are horrible, then juniors can only
try to do
little bit. So in that sense, situation is really, really dire. But the thing is, the UN is paralyzed, you know that.
Of course, yeah, it's important.
That's one sad thing. And Bangladesh, the best friend of India, the best friend of Bangladesh, is not helping at all.
Yes, ma'am.
And China, on the other hand, is putting spanner on everything. So while we should, humanitarian assistance and everything should continue in whatever way, and UNHCR and Save the Children and others are working, and Muslim NGOs are part. And because Muslim NGOs, whatever their strength is, part is insignificant compared to the demand. So, it's a there should be a massive reawakening of Muslim in the sense of putting pressure. The problem that we face as a community, many of us don't have any connections with our local MP. We have transnational politics in this country. If we put pressure on our local MPs, they can raise the voice in parliament. But many Muslims don't have any clue as to how to do that.
Yes.
So only thing some people can do is go and shout a bit in some place, which is important. Some shouting is needed. But that shouting, unless it's backed up by lobbying and other things, is not going to work.
Thank you for coming here for the important issue affecting much of the world today. First of all, I want to ask, why has the Rohingya situation gained so much traction today as opposed to previously? And to what extent would you say that social media has played a huge part in that? Also, I'd like to ask, how feasible are the goals of repatriating the Rohingya and granting them citizenships? There's many reports of so many houses being razed, burned, and in place of that, military installations, military bases and police stations have been built on top of that. So, I'd like to know also if those goals are not met, is it reasonable for the Bangladeshi government to consider maybe temporarily granting citizenship to the Rohingya?
Okay, so the first question is, it is Rohingyas are in the radar, the people's radar now. Because what has been happening since 1963, people ignored. If Bangladesh was only a powerful country, then it could have sorted out by bilateral discussion with Burma or through UN's help in 1978. And the problem is, like many Muslim countries, Bangladesh is not strong. So that's another. On the other hand, some right-wing media in India, and mainly in India and Burma as well, they're trying to portray that Rohingyas have been terrorists. I mentioned that briefly because IHRC is a ragtag group of people. Now, whether that was a creation of the Burmese establishment or some other country, some people say that it is Pakistani ISI or Americans have created them. Nobody knows this, right? I don't have any preview on any intelligence information. But IHRC was virtually, there was the Harakatul Yaqeen, there's another group who was there before. And someone like Bert Lantner and many others would have written that. So this IHRC as a boogeyman, using IHRC as a boogeyman, has been one of the reasons how those who are Islamophobes, they just take it up and try to say that, okay, it was because Burma has been disproportionate, but what Burma did probably was okay. So that's one thing. Now, after this 1.1 million people settling in Burma, there are news in Burma as well as in Bangladesh. And this is under the radar of intelligence world. What I'm hearing that some governments, whether it's Saudi through America, nobody knows, are trying to enlist more Burmese Muslims, Rohingya Muslims, to fight him. There's a global political reason, that could be some other things. And whether Bangladesh government knows it, that's totally different area. So that this terrorism side of suffering could be a reality, could be a harsh reality if UN fails or the world fails to repatriate. And there are always hotheads, and normally all these refugee camps are the breeding ground for extremism. So there is possibility. I hope it doesn't happen, but you never know. Now, repatriation, as I mentioned, to me, Bangladesh government in last November had MOU with Burma, but it was just a fake. Not exactly fake. Bangladesh, as a Bangladeshi person, diplomatically Bangladesh has been outmaneuvered by Burma, as far as my information goes. But because UN didn't accept Bangladeshi government's MOU with the Burmese government, so that became a no news. Now even UN in the last month, there was news that UN is going to have a memorandum of understanding on the basis of Burmese government's promise that they will be taken back and they will be repatriated. Nobody believed even UN. UN was fooled, in my opinion. Well, what my understanding is that those who work for the Burmese, say Burma, Burma Campaign UK and many others who I work with, the opinion is, unless UN, unless UN is really, really serious and determined, Burmese establishment will take few thousands or probably take some good number, and they will be put into the IDP camps. They will not be taken back to their own homes. So in that sense, repatriation in the current political scenario of the world and Burmese government attitude is, to me, useless. It is not happening. So the world is in a stalemate, because the world has to deal with Brexit, our country. America has to deal with Putin and other things. And so who is going to, the world has lost its leadership. whether anything changes suddenly within 3 years, I don't know. So I'm not able to give any positive pictures. That's what I'm talking about, the civil society always, because that's where I can really contribute a little bit. I don't have a high contact with UN or even in the British establishment. British, as I said, Britain can do many things, but Britain is struggling with Brexit and its trade relations and all sorts of things. It doesn't answer your question, but that's the reality.
And final question from Dr. Bari.
This is just an online comment from Linda Hioki, and she says, I met Dr. Bari in a conference in Istanbul and I was happy to be informed about his publication. Please keep up doing the good work, Doctor.
You mentioned briefly about how the Buddhist Samyama didn't like the test, the Muslim Rohingya, because the Muslim Rohingya side of the British. But could you elaborate more? Why did they really hate them to the point of trying to
why the Burmese Buddhists hate Rohingya to this extent? I mentioned a little bit. One is, in the 1930s, when there was an economic crisis, global economic crisis, the Burmese Buddhists, they are known as lazy. And Burmese women are more active than Burmese men. That's what, as someone who is near to Burma, I know this. Burmese men are lazy, women are more active. So what happened? They couldn't farm their own lands. Britain had to take Indians, Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, to cultivate the Burmese land, because Britain needed money. You know, Britain was a colonial power. Western colonialism was based on economic greed. So Britain needed more economic prosperity. And Burmese farmers were not able to deliver that. They were not experts, they were lazy. So they took hundreds of thousands of Indians and Bengalis, including Muslims, because India has got Hindus, and Sikhs and Muslims. So what happened? In the 1930s, when there was an economic crisis, Burmese Buddhists had to sell land, so has to sell or lend or whatever. And Indians took over. So once you lose your land, then you don't blame yourself for losing your land because you're lazy. Lazy people also become angry that these are the people who took our lands. Because they were economically outmaneuvered. So that was one reason. So they started hating Indians, not only Rohingya Muslims. Second one, when Japan invaded Burma, or occupied it, Japan was horrible power. You know, Japan is worse than anything else. They used Burmese Buddhists for their own goal. You know, colonial powers, invading powers always use divide and rule policies. So Japan used Burmese Buddhists who had majority, who supported them. And Rohingya, because they were hated by the Burmese, they supported Britain. So two fighting powers, Rohingya on British side, Burmese on the Japanese side. So they fought, you know, the secondary fighting, like the, what's that called, proxy war, sort of. And as a result, I'm not saying Burmese were horrible, some of the Rohingyas were also horrible, definitely tit for tat. On one occasion, there's many stories. Britain gave Rohingya weapons. They attacked Burmese, and they drove away from the area where they were majority. And Burmese Buddhists also did the similar thing, so this went on. So the hatred peaked until Britain defeated Japan. So this land loss and the hatred because of the war, that continued from 45 to 48. Now, only person who could solve this and bring peace in Burma was Suu Kyi's father, Aung San. He was General Aung San. But he was that, and he formed the Burmese military. Burmese military was not an entity, it was a British military, and he from Burmese military, so he was the father figure. And he was multilateralist, and he was very good, and he had Muslim friends, non-Muslim friends, and but he was with his whole cabinet, like they were meeting him here, he was blown up. So once they were blown up, then also democracy continued for 48 until 62, 14 years. But during that period, Rohingya were struggling, but they were having their rights. When the military came, and people say that those military generals also killed Aung San, they made the decision, determination that these Rohingya people should not exist. That's how it came. And of course, Rohingya Muslims, social, political, diplomatic and other capitals were getting very low gradually. So they were becoming like a pariah, most weak people.
Just to add to that, the region where Rohingya people are located in Rakhine State, from a geographic point of view, it's very strategic. And you know, China gets access to the Bay of Bengal. You know, India can trade with Burma through this route, and it's so. And as alluded to earlier on by Dr. Bari, it's a very resource-rich country, and people are trying to exploit the riches of the country. So I know India has been awarded hundreds of millions of dollars worth of investments of infrastructure building. China has done the same thing. And that region is needs to be evacuated. They don't want problems there. So,
just in regards to right-wing nationalism that's been rising in Europe, has there been something that comparatively, you know, a right-wing party in Bangladesh growing as a result of the media crisis, or this fear of, you know, migrants coming in?
In Bangladesh?
Yeah, or is there more sympathy?
Well, Bangladeshi politics is very different. But in Bangladesh, generally people are very moderate. And at the moment, one party is virtually one party rule in Bangladesh. That's the whole issue. And the other political parties, political opponents are virtually non-existent. And India has a bigger role that's playing, and so India's role is very regional, big brother. And there's a news today by Avaaz, and I know this, but 5 million Assamese Muslim, Assam, you know, Indian, one of the provinces in India, Modi's government in India. They are playing politics with Muslim numbers. And in Assam, Muslims live there as citizens, but many of them don't have paper, like the Rohingyas. And I think Buddhist government is now planning to deport Muslims in Assam who don't have paper. Paper means documented paper, to prove that they are Indian citizens. So if 5 million Muslims are evicted, they will, where would they go? China isn't going to take them, probably they'll come to Bangladesh. So they like the right-wing fascist group that are available in some European countries. I don't see any fascist right-wing or leftist people in Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, it's a political problem. The government party, which is very powerful, and opposition, which is doesn't have any power. That's the only problem in Bangladesh, in my observation.
Just to add also that the Rohingya aren't the only persecuted minorities in Myanmar. You've got Rohingya Hindus as well, but also there's minority Christian groups. So there's recent reports that Christian churches have been destroyed, and in replacement they've built Buddhist temples. And the Shan people have been persecuted for a number of decades as well. So I know from experience, when working in humanitarian sector, when they allow us to operate in Myanmar to support the Rohingyas, they said that to be able to support the Rohingyas, you have to support all other minorities to keep the minority people happy, because they've been persecuting the same group of people.
If I can also add to that, so the name of the predominantly Christian ethnic group that's being attacked, they're called the Kachin, and they're situated in the north of Myanmar, border with China. I think the difference between the Kachin and the Rohingya is that the Rohingya are relatively unarmed, whilst the Kachin have their own insurgency, so do the Shan people. In fact, there are many ethnic groups that have been fighting the Myanmar government for autonomy or secession.
Kachin, Chin, Shan, Karen, you know, all of them have, they are recognized as ethnic minority. And all of them have got them in their backyard, their supporters. Say, Christian Karens are supported by the West. Kachin and Chin are supported by China. So Burma will go to a certain extent, not to the extent of Rohingya, because they know that Rohingya don't have anyone to support, anyone to get support from. So that's probably the officials. Military are very, very clever.
Who's the Bangladeshi government? Who are they relying on for financial support internationally? Is anyone there focusing
on? At the moment, they only rely on India. But the Indian Modi government, not only Modi, the previous government also, they are playing.
For support for the Rohingya, are they relying on anyone financially, Middle East, or anyone?
But the UN supports many of the projects, because the UNHCR is the main human rights humanitarian body. And most of the aid work goes through the UNHCR. Even Save the Children, Oxfam and others, they have to go to the UNHCR. In that sense, UNHCR is doing a good job in that sense. And the problem is, UNHCR depends on support from individual governments, their contribution. Britain contributes 0.7 of his budget. Other countries don't do this. So, as I mentioned, Turkey has got a bigger heart because it accommodates 3.5 million Syrians. Turkey also requested Sheikh Hasina, Prime Minister, to help the Rohingyas. But other Muslim countries like Saudi Arabia and others, they will spend money on something else. So Bangladesh, in that sense, doesn't have any genuine friend, in that sense.
One more question. Okay. I may be betraying my ignorance, but you mentioned how Suchi just changed when she became the councillor in the state. But I'm a bit confused. If her husband, her father was assassinated by those who are now in power, why would she suddenly change so much? I don't understand that.
She got a Nobel Prize and she was venerated in the whole world, you know that?
Yeah.
She was next to Nelson Mandela, and the people who praised Nelson Mandela, like I mentioned some of them, Archbishop Desmond Tutu and our singer, Irish singer, was Bob Geldof. People who have seen her change, they hate her like anything. It's power. One is, she probably thought that she would be able to maneuver, and but the Burmese military are many, many times cleverer and sharper than her. That's one. The other is she might have dislike for Muslims as well. You know, she was interviewed by Michel Hussein. Some people know this. And after the interview, she knew that Michel Hussein is Muslim. Then she her microphone was not off. She made an off comment that I was not told that she is a Muslim woman. That means she doesn't like Muslims. And how much dislike she has for Muslims is very difficult to know that now. So circumstantial evidence is she has given in, and she is now, she doesn't use the word Rohingya. When Pope Paul went to that Naypyidaw, and she her official categorically mentioned that Pope doesn't mention the word Rohingya. Pope didn't do this. And Pope, when he came to Bangladesh camps, he used the word Rohingya. So some of us in our tweets, we criticized the Pope. Because in the past, Pope supported Rohingya. But Burmese Catholic Church advised him not to use the word Rohingya. So that means Suchi even doesn't use the word Rohingya. Like the military, she calls Bengali terrorists. So this is probably what, you know, power is something else in this world.